Broadcasting from the campus of Lynn Benton Community College, we are the Mid-Valley STEM-CTE Hub. I'm your host, Casey, and this is Closing the Gap. Hello, listeners. Today on Closing the Gap, we are talking with Alaina Percival, the co-founder and CEO of the organization Women Who Code. Hi, Alaina. It's great to have you on the show. How are you doing today?
I'm great. Thank you for having me.
It's my pleasure. Can we start off with you telling the listeners a little bit about yourself?
Oh, sure. Yeah. So I'm originally from Atlanta. And I've taken a bit of a winding career path. I, after graduating from university, ended up going over to Germany with a congressional scholarship for a year. And then I got a job at Puma, so the shoe company, and stayed there for an additional 3 years. And then I went back to school and did a MBA. It was actually a dual degree program, so master's in organizational management and an MBA. And I went to a small women's performance footwear company. So I kind of was transitioning into women's empowerment space. While that was always important to me personally, it was now showing up professionally. And a little over a year after that, I had the opportunity to move to San Francisco. And it was just one of those cities where if you get a chance to move there, yes, it was on my list to absolutely do it. So I did. And I had an amazing career up until that point. And I hit a little bit of a wall. I wasn't coming from, you know, Facebook or Microsoft or Google. And so my background wasn't automatically translating. So I started learning how to code and getting involved in the tech industry. And that's how I started to move into the Women Who Code space, and just really fell in love with spending time with smart women talking about technology. And I started to realize it was important. I saw that fewer than 5% of the people getting, you know, the top technical leadership roles were women. And I said, hey, you know, my background in organizational management and community building is actually really helpful for bringing in what I'm learning from, you know, executives in the tech industry. So that's how I found my way to Women Who Code. I've now moved back to Atlanta. I have two children, 2.5 and 4.5. And so a lot of my free time is monopolized by them, but I get to be part of this just incredible movement. Women Who Code's the largest and most active community of diverse women technologists in the world. And every one of us at the company, either as employees or volunteers, gets to show up for work every day, trying to make a difference and truly making a difference.
So you had mentioned that you were seeing fewer than 5% of women in the tech industry. Is that how you kind of identified this need to build this organization?
Yeah. So originally it was just a meetup group in San Francisco, and a group of, you know, smart women in the tech industry having fun. We were like a close community. And I realized it was important because the world started talking about teaching girls to code and teaching women to code. And the media wasn't talking about the needs of the women in the industry or really working at dismantling the biases that they were facing, preventing them from staying in their careers and making it to more senior positions. And so what I realized is, you know, we have this community and it's not just fun, it's actually important. And we need to be elevating the needs of women in the industry alongside getting girls to code and getting women to go into to software engineering positions, that you actually need to be supporting all pieces of the funnel, because what we want is for the women choosing the career and for the young girls aspiring to come into an industry that can better support them, that can better elevate them, and that they can have an even bigger difference in.
Totally. Yeah. I know that you were just kind of touching on part of the mission of Women Who Code, but could you maybe go more in depth with that and how you guys are working to actually like accomplish your goal?
Yeah. So Women Who Code's mission is to inspire women to excel in technology careers. So everyone is welcome. All levels are welcome. But what we really hone in on is the person in the industry, making sure that she's building the skills and the leadership skills, the technical and leadership skills to succeed and make it to the most senior position of their dreams. And so what we do is offer close to 2,000 free technical events annually. So that's an average of about 5 per day. We're deeply dedicated to access. So all of our programming, whether it's the scholarships we're giving away, the events that we're having, it's all free or scholarship accessible. And so it's a great way for, you know, if you are considering transitioning into the tech industry, or if you are still a student, connecting with people in the industry, because it doesn't have that barrier of a price tag in front of it. And it also is just important because, you know, women find it so difficult to invest in themselves. And so we constantly work to make it easier to lower the barrier to actually investing in yourself, in your career. And to be honest, it's fun. You make friends, you learn things, you build projects. I remember there was a time when we were still in person. You know, we haven't been in person for 2 years now, but we went around the room and said, hey, you know, why did you join Women Who Code? Or if you have been a member of Women Who Code, like how has it impacted your career? And everyone went around and I was blown away. One person said, you know, I decided to do a hackathon with someone at Women Who Code and we won. And then the next person said, you know, I work remotely. And so it's just amazing to be in a space where there's other people and I feel as though, you know, like I'm part of something. And, you know, another person said, I was looking for a job and pointed to the person next to them and was like, and she told me to interview at her company and now we're colleagues. And so, you know, there's all of these like pieces that are huge for people's lives. And, you know, when we surveyed our members in the past, actually 80% of the members said they'd had a positive career outcome as being part of Women Who Code.
How does someone become a member of Women Who Code? Is there like a membership, or is it just like you kind of get on, you know, like a chat room kind of thing, or like what does it look like for someone trying to join?
So easy. You go to womenwhocode.com and there's a button that says join and you only have to sign up. So there's no fee to signing up, and you'll get access to our scholarships, our ticket giveaways, all of our events. You can sign up to be a volunteer, which is skill-based volunteering. So why that's important is because women are often judged based on their experience when they're getting promoted, and men are often judged based on their potential. And so people say, oh, he's got so much potential to be a leader. And for a woman, they say, oh, you know, she's never been a leader before. How do we know she'd be good at it? And so it gives you a platform to practice leadership and demonstrate that you have those and build those leadership skills.
That's wonderful. I feel like it was really powerful when you were talking about how men are promoted based on their potential and women on their experience. So why is it important for women to be highlighted in tech? And also that we pursue a more equal balance of women to men and getting more women like in leadership roles?
Yeah, I feel like that's a multi-part question. One,
yeah,
that's
a big one.
it's smart business. Companies that have women represented at the executive level make more money. Teams that have diversity on it are smarter and more creative. Study after study tells us this. And, you know, there aren't enough engineers right now to meet the current market needs. And so we actually need more people engaging and succeeding and staying in the tech industry across the board. The other reason I think it's incredibly important is because every industry is becoming a technology industry right now. And so whether you want to choose a path to leadership in media, healthcare, finance, shipping, agriculture, no matter what it is, all of these are becoming technology industries. And so really, if you want to move into a path, into a leadership role in a company, you will be leading a technology organization. So more and more often, having that background, understanding data security, it's going to be as important as, you know, traditionally having that, you know, finance background, where you would see leaders emerging.
For sure. I feel like it's a good thing to promote students coming into the workforce to not be scared of taking tech classes or computer science kinds of things, because I totally agree. Everything is going online, especially with the pandemic and how it's been for the last couple of years. And in general, it's just so much more efficient, it seems. So a little while back, you had mentioned again about women not being promoted based on faith that they can do good. They need to prove it first. What are some other challenges that you're seeing that women facing in the tech industry and in kind of getting to those roles, or even maybe getting out of a educational path and starting a career?
Yeah. So one of the things that we see in that Women Who Code, we're working to create a cultural shift around it, is it's a little more uncomfortable for women to talk about their career successes. And it's a little bit more uncomfortable for society to hear us do it. It's viewed as bragging versus, you know, just representing your successes. And so, you know, we need allies to help amplify, you know, the everyday successes of women. And we also need to make it okay and comfortable for women to talk about those successes. And I realized how important this was a couple of years ago when I was speaking to a director of engineering at a company. She said to me, Alaina, oh, you know, that's right. I'm actually senior director of engineering, and I've been embarrassed to update my LinkedIn profile.
Wow.
She has a job title, she has a pay increase, she has like all of this legitimacy and recognition around this achievement. So you can imagine every single day when you're in the workplace and you've, you know, put forward an idea, or you've contributed to a code base, or you did really well on a project, how difficult it is for women to elevate their successes when they don't have all of these like external legitimizing factors. And so it's really important, one, that the culture changes, that the next generation is able to talk about their career successes, because, you know, if you can't talk about it, people don't know to promote you. They don't know to give you a pay increase. They don't know to try and get you to join their team because you're so good. And so it's critical and really adds up throughout the lifetime of your career. And so we need allies to help us overcome this bias, and culturally we need to be able to change.
For sure. What does a good ally to women in the workplace look like?
You know, I think that it's different for different people, but a good ally keeps trying. They keep testing out different methods. I was watching a panel yesterday evening, and a young woman said that she was in a meeting with 80 people, about 15 people have talked, and a white man said, "We haven't heard from a single woman." Like, actually stopped the meeting and said, you know, we need to make sure we're hearing diverse voices this very important topic. And, you know, that's was a big enough moment that it resonated not only with this person, but enough to share in a platform that, you know, was shared with 100 people in that moment. And then, you know, the people who are now joining this. And so the little tiny things, you know, elevating when someone gets cut off. Women are 3 times more likely to be interrupted when they're putting forth an idea or sharing in a meeting setting. And so, you know, finding a way to say, oh, I don't think, you know, she was finished speaking yet. Let's let her finish her thought before moving on. You know, finding these steps, going to her, because also women apply for jobs and promotions once they have all of the qualifications. Sometimes I've even often seen women doing the job before they go for the promotion, saying, like, letting them know, hey, you should ask for this promotion, trying to wedge open some of those doors, and reminding them to elevate what they want in their career, because it's not that women aren't ambitious. It's that society treats us differently when we represent our ambition.
For sure. Yeah, I can definitely see what you're saying. And I like a lot of those ideas. It just sounds like also being like a good coworker in general.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So you were talking about how you didn't necessarily start in the tech industry. Could you kind of tell us how you, you know, reskilled and started going in this direction later in your career?
Yeah, there's so many resources available online. If you go to Women Who Code's resources page, there's also community groups like Women Who Code and many other organizations that have resources to be able to learn to code. And the exciting thing about it is that technology changes so quickly that you're often only, you know, maybe a couple years behind someone who's very experienced in a programming language, because, you know, every 3 to 5 years that person's probably now working in an entirely new programming language. The one thing that I would say, especially if there's, you know, younger people tuning in, is every time that I've seen someone learning to code later on in life, like trying to make that transition professionally, they've had even one coding class prior to, you know, continuous learning as an adult. They learn so much faster. So if you are thinking about what you're going to do for summer camp, if you're thinking about what you're going to do, you know, picking up one CS class, if you're not sure that you actually want to become a software engineer, still take a class if it's accessible to you. If it's not, like, teach yourself, do an online class. You know, there's Coursera, edX, all of these, Udemy, all of these ways to kind of just get that foundation.
So what do you think can be done locally and even globally to get women into the tech industry and retain them in tech companies?
So, I mean, truly, I think coding needs to be part of the core curriculum starting at the elementary school level. And we need to be seeing that change to be able to capture, you know, the historically excluded minorities, low income women, from having high potential technology careers later on in life. And so that's, you know, if I could wave my magic wand, that's the big change that I would be asking for. But what companies can be doing is making sure that they're examining their processes for equality. So if you put a job post out there and 95% of the applicants that you're getting are men, then you have a pipeline issue. If you have fixed your pipeline issue and, you know, 95% of the people getting through the interview process are now men again, it means you need to fix your interview process. And then when you find that promotions, you know, 95% of the people getting the promotions are men, it means you need to fix your promotion process. And starting all over again, because as soon as you fix something, there's going to be something else to fix later on. So a continuous cycle of evaluation.
We don't see a large number of women in comparison to the amount of men that are going into tech. And I was hoping maybe you could shine some light on young women and people of gender minorities that are listening to the show on why they should consider pursuing an educational path and a career in tech.
Tech is a fantastic career path. If you look at any of the lists that say, you know, top 10 jobs, well-paid, good hours, great working environment, probably 4 or 5 of those are going to be technology related. There's so much career potential right now. And the truth is, the industry's only going to be better with you in it. And so you choosing this career path, you bringing your whole self into companies, you elevating when you see how companies can be better, how the industry can be better, and helping to make that change, it's only going to get better. But the tech industry isn't going away. Like I said, every industry is becoming a tech industry. And so choosing to be part of it and to help create the pieces that are molding what we are using and having every day. Also, we need your perspective on that. And so it's so important to have that diverse set of voices, not only defining what our products are, being part of companies, being part of wealth generation. We want you to create the ideas that haven't been created yet, because your ideas might be better than any of the ideas that are currently out there.
Earlier in our talk, you were mentioning how, you know, women have a hard time kind of being proud of their accomplishments. And I was wondering, would you be willing to be an example and share some of the accomplishments that you're most proud of in your career?
For me, it's pretty easy because I'm able to divert it to other people's successes. So what drives me to wake up every day and feel passionate about what I do is the stories and the like individual outcomes that I hear for people who are in our community, volunteers, like the leaders who are in our community. So when, you know, our director in Mexico City told me that her salary had increased 200% since becoming a Woman Who Code director, and that was in under 1 year. Wow. That is one of the things I'm most proud of. When the woman came up to me at an event and said that she had been coming to our Python events and ended up becoming a data scientist, and now she was a senior data scientist and being flown across the country to speak at a conference. That is one of the things I'm most proud of. And when a woman who received one of our first scholarships, and she was a single mother who was living below the poverty line, let me know that she had a software engineering role at LinkedIn. And I have an understanding of how much money you make as a software engineer at LinkedIn and what that means for her and her family. That is one of the things that I'm most proud of. I can keep going, you know, for days and days, because, you know, I have the honor of being part of this mission.
That sounds so rewarding. I love that. It's wonderful. So perhaps there are, you know, students listening to this or people that are looking to kind of re-educate and go into tech, but maybe they're not like so interested in coding. Could you maybe talk about some career options that are out there that people could pursue to be in the tech industry but not have to code at all?
Yeah. So right now, you know, in the tech industry, in the like development side of things, the no code, low code development of products is huge. So I would say that's one area that's emerging a lot. So if you start to learn how to code, but you realize that, you know, you don't necessarily want to really be deep in using code for problem solving, kind of a little bit more from scratch, there's this new emerging way of development. But then there's also product management. So think about the product or the app on your phone that you use most frequently. How could it be better? If you were the product manager, it would probably have that feature. And there's project manager. So if you're good at organization, making sure that things are hitting their timeline and that goals are clear and everyone is working toward the same area. There's people who are doing technical communication. So documentation, if you're a strong writer and you're good at driving clarity, that might be a path that you would choose. There's marketing, that's heavily involving analytics these days. It's very strongly connected to having that technology mindset, being an entrepreneur, building your own company, understanding what you can build, what you can hire people to do. So there's such a spectrum of really any area of business that is now the tech industry. And honestly, the companies that I get super excited about are the ones that are traditional industry, but using technology to dramatically improve upon it, so that that could be the trucking industry, that could be it doesn't have to be this like traditional technology industry. And I think the experiences and your lived experience informs what you can imagine really developing and shifting the world. I remember when I moved Women Who Code's headquarters from San Francisco to Atlanta, I just thought, you've kind of got this insular, like, how can we get pizza to us faster sort of like development mentality. But when you move to other parts of the country, other parts of the world, that's when you see people who their lived experience is different. And so they are able to innovate in entirely new ways.
I think that's great. I feel like so often that we put this idea of having a career in tech into a little neat box that, you have to fit inside of it or you're not part of it. But I like it's a very empowering idea that really anything that you do, you can get into this like industry that's just booming and can only take you up with it. Mm-hmm. Do you have any words of advice for young women or people of gender minorities that are looking to pursue a career in tech? I know that we talked about getting that foundational knowledge, but can we take it a step further?
Yeah. So what I recommend is connecting with people who have recently entered the tech industry. So maybe they are one or two levels above where you would hope to be. Maybe they're an intern at the company. Maybe they are, just one level above or two levels above that. Ask them, what do they love about their job? What do they love about the company? What skills made them right for that company? And you know what? Before you hang up, say, hey, if I saw a job at your company, would you be willing to refer me? And people are so accessible these days, with Twitter and LinkedIn. You can reach out to someone, say, could I have a 10-minute Zoom conversation with you? And it's very easy to make that happen. And if you make it easy for people to help you, they're likely to be willing to do so.
That's excellent. Well, do you have anything that you would like to promote? So is there anything that's, big coming up for you?
Yeah. So Women Who Code has our annual Connect conference coming up at the end of May. And we have scholarship tickets available. That doesn't mean that it's only going to a few people. It means if you apply for a scholarship ticket, you're going to get it. So I encourage everyone who's listening to this to go to our Twitter handle, at Women Who Code, visit womenwhocode.com, sign up for our newsletter, and please join us at our conference at the end of May.
Awesome. That's great news. Well, those are all the questions I have for you today. I really appreciate you coming on the show and speaking with me today.
Thank you.
Thank you for joining us for this episode of Closing the Gap. If you like this show, subscribe on Spotify. You can also find us on Instagram at MVSTEMCTE, on Twitter at MidValleySTEM, and online at MidValleySTEM.org. Until next time, keep progressing.